Hey, how you doing? Christopher Mosley here. And today I'm here to talk about the Panasonic GH4. The Panasonic GH4 is a mirrorless Micro Four Thirds legend of a camera with 4K quality and 8-bit performance that is astounding down to the very small details. But it also has its shortcomings with poor low light performance and not very good native lens selection. Is it worth it to buy this camera in 2017? Let's find out. Quick introduction to this camera. This camera is mainly used for professional run and gun videography work, such as music videos, weddings, and live events, and things of that sort. Now, the only major downfall of this type of camera is the native lens selection. Now, Panasonic offers some great lenses, but they are very, very expensive, and you don't really have much to choose from, so they don't really compete with the Canon L series lenses. But there is a solution to that. They offer third-party adapters such as the Metabone Speed Booster and Photodiox, where you can use these adapters to adapt Canon lenses to a Micro Four Thirds body such as the Panasonic GH4, taking your video quality to a whole nother level. But is it worth the cost? Let's talk about the build quality of this camera. With a magnesium alloy body and a very sturdy, healthy feel, it's very comfortable to use out in the field. And I feel like it can survive a few drops and spills here or there. Now, I wouldn't recommend using this out in a very heavy rain type situation or trying to submerge it into water, but I wouldn't worry about things like maybe a little sprinkling or, you know, a little splash here and there. It's very durable, and I feel like they put a lot of time into designing this camera and the feel of the camera. It's mainly magnesium alloy on the inside with a few plastic parts here and there, but when you feel it, it's very sturdy and very comfortable in your hands, and it will balance out with your lenses. Now, it has a very responsive touchscreen that I really don't use a lot because I'm really not used to using a touchscreen camera coming from Canon 5D Mark III and Canon 6D, but it's very useful to have. When I do want to go through my menu and use the touchscreen, I can do that. It's nice to have that as an option. It's nice to have a flip-out screen. So in case I want to maybe do some vlogging or frame myself up to do some YouTube reviews or product reviews and tutorials and things of that sort, I have that option now. Coming from the Canon 6D and 5D Mark III, I didn't have that option. I would have to hook up a monitor. But it's nice to just have that type of option. The screen feels very durable. I don't feel like it will break on me unless I do some neglectful things to it. So it's nice to have a nice, sturdy swivel screen on it. It's a very good build. And as my first Panasonic or Lumix camera, I'm very impressed by this camera. Now, let's talk about the value of this camera. Directly from Panasonic, we're talking about around $1,199.99 straight from the manufacturer, which is a little steep, but not really when you think about what you're getting in this package. You're getting introduced to 4K quality at 24 frames per second, and you're getting introduced to variable frame rates where you can get 96 frames per second in 1080p. Now, that's powerful when it comes to stuff like music videos or really anything like vlog footage. It's very cinematic to get that much slow motion. Now, the most you get is 60 frames per second out of the Canon cameras unless you bump up to a 5D Mark IV or the Cinema series with a C100. So it's very useful to get that type of frame rate. That's powerful to get that type of frame rate at that price. Another thing I have to mention is the lens selection and having to buy adapters or to purchase a Micro Four Thirds lens. Now, when you add in the cost of a Metabone Speed Booster, and why it's important to get that type of adapter is they have a lot of cheap adapters that you can use but will not give you electronic control of your lens. Now, personally, I don't have a Metabone Speed Booster yet. It's around $600 for the good one. I don't have one yet, so I'm using a cheap adapter that allows me to just mount my lens onto the camera with no electronic control. no autofocus. I cannot stop my lens down, which means if it's an f1.4 or 1.2 lens, it's wide open all the time. Now, that's very difficult to use when you're talking about music videos. Things like what I'm recording right now, not so much, because I can focus it and it stays there. But when you're coming to do music videos and tracking someone and they're moving a lot and flashing money and dancing, you're not going to be able to stay in focus at those shallow depths of field. I do use a variable ND filter to kind of control the lighting and dim it down, but I'm still not able to keep it in the focus. So you have to add that cost in when you talk about the value of this camera. Still a good price, depends on your lens system. Now, if you're already a Micro Four Thirds user, hey, you have nothing to lose. You already have the lenses you need. But I had to mention that adapter situation because that's a very valid point when you talk about the price. $1,199, $600 for the adapter. I'm getting up into the $2,000 range. You know, I could buy a 6D Mark II, but I won't get 4K. So it's really going to be up to you and your production and what it is that you're doing if this camera is going to be the camera for you or worth it. In my opinion, it is when I see the end result of what I'm getting. And eventually, I do plan on getting that speed booster. So it just depends on what type of company you're running and what type of productions you're producing with your camera. Now, let's talk about the useful features of this camera and what makes it worth it. Now, one very cool thing about this camera is it has a lock, like a locking mechanism on the mode dial. So there's no way for you to really twist this unless you click it and unlock it, and then you're able to switch modes on it. I found that very useful. Also, we'll have to mention the 96 frames per second frame rate, the 4K quality, and not to mention, you know, people don't really mention that there's a wide variety of ways you can shoot in megabytes per second with this camera. Like, you just, when you pick it up, you realize this is a film camera. This is a short film music video type of camera. It's not really built for photography, but if you know how to use it, you can definitely get good pictures with this camera. Now, I've been posting pictures with this camera on Instagram. I haven't had it long, but no one will know the difference. Like, it's not a poor photography camera, let me put it like that. This camera also has a time-lapse mode that allows you to set it up to do specifically time-lapse with this dial here. And what you do is you set it in the time-lapse mode, how many second intervals you want to use, and it will build a time-lapse in camera for you. That way, when you connect your camera to your computer, it will already be in time-lapse form. You don't have to deal with placing the photos in your timeline and rearranging them and building that time lapse. It comes a time lapse straight into your camera and you can view it that way in your camera. Very useful if you do time lapse. Reality TV shows and weddings and things of that nature are starting to demand time lapse because you see that when you watch a television show. So that's a very useful feature. The flip out screen is very useful. I already touched on that a little bit earlier. It has dynamic battery life. It can be compared to your Canon full-frame cameras because you can, use this battery for a day or maybe two if you shoot like me. I'm very selective with the way I shoot. I don't shoot for 30 or 45 minutes straight. I do quick 5 to 7 second clips, and that's how I build my music videos, weddings, and things like that, unless it's a performance shot. So very useful to have good battery life. Now, something also that I would have to mention that's dynamic about this camera is the color profiles. You have Vlog, you have Sandy, which is free. That one, I think, comes with the camera or it doesn't cost much. And you have Vlog, that's $100. But I've been pretty satisfied with the Sandy profile. You know, it gives you a very flat color profile that's supposed to give you better dynamic range with this camera. I've been experimenting with that, and I really enjoy color grading this camera because Canon cameras just don't shoot flat like that. The most you can get is turning your saturation down and sharpness, but this shoots in a very, very flat profile, that look you want if you want to do some very good color grading. So that's a very useful tool. This camera comes equipped with focus peaking and zebras. So you're able to look at what you're filming and see what's in focus because it will give you a blue kind of contrasty look and let you know what you have in focus right on screen without having to download Magic Lantern or any of those third party apps. It will show you what you have in focus and show you what your colors look like right in camera. That's why people say this is a good video camera. All that stuff is already built in on this camera. And another very powerful tool is the electronic viewfinder. Now, most of my Canon users won't be familiar with this. Sony users, yeah, you're probably familiar with it, but you can look right through the viewfinder and film through the viewfinder and actually change your exposure and all that stuff with a live view. You know, with Canon cameras, you might have to snap a pic, go back and change your exposure. You can look through this viewfinder, expose your shot, and all the tools that are available on the screen are available in your viewfinder. Like, that is so powerful. I didn't quite understand that until I picked this camera up. So all my Canon users, don't knock that until you try it, man, because it's so powerful. It's very useful and it will really spoil you, and you'll be looking for that feature when you pick up other cameras. So keep that in mind, man. That's a very powerful tool that I didn't think would be that powerful. Now, in conclusion, man, this is just a great camera. It's a beautiful camera. It's easy to use, and because it's not so good in low light, it really challenges you to use your light wisely, because if you use your light wisely, it'll really make your shots better and it'll really make you a better videographer. Because with my Canon 6D and Canon 5D Mark III, I could shoot in any lighting situations and basically get no noise as long as I stay around ISO 3200. You're not going to be able to go over ISO 800 with this camera, but guess what? If you use your light wisely, you won't have to. It will make you a better videographer, and I mean that seriously. But overall, other than the poor low light performance and having to purchase those adapters, this is a great camera, man. I'm going to have to recommend that you at least rent this camera and try it out. Go buy one if you got the money, but give it a shot, man. Before you purchase the GH5, give the GH4 a shot and try out this system, man. It's a beautiful system, and I'm really kind of down on myself for not trying this system as early as I did, because it's beautiful, man. And Panasonic, keep up the good work, because now you have a customer. Now I'm going to keep a Panasonic camera in my bag because I've been introduced to that quality. So keep up the good work, man. Hey, if you're not already subscribed, go ahead and subscribe to my channel. I do a lot of product reviews, tutorials, and things of that nature. So go ahead and subscribe to my channel so you won't miss out on future things that I may post, man. I appreciate everybody that's already subscribed. I noticed that I broke 1,000 subscribers, which isn't a lot in the grand scheme of things, but hey, coming from a small town guy like me, I really appreciate everybody that's subscribed to my channel. I appreciate each and every one of you. Leave a like if I did a good job doing a good review of this camera.